So what we were doing was we were finding that in terms of the surpluses, these are the countries that are actually finding a greater number of students that needed access, and they were actually going to schools in the primary school settings currently. North Korea, Nepal, India, Cambodia, all of these countries were actually doing something. They had surpluses. But as you can see, there's a staggering amount of students that are going through the system. This is where the problems are with the shortfalls. We're finding that there's a significant amount of students that are not actually going and not having access to primary school in these countries. A significant amount, actually. But what this does is it helps to demonstrate that we are not recognizing that we need institutions to actually accommodate all these students that are going through the system, providing that there are many that are actually shifting borders in order to get a better education. We're also recognizing that quality of education is important. And so when we talk about what is a basic education, what does basic education actually mean? In 2008, I was asked by UNESCO to start looking at this for tertiary education. So we're looking at this idea of projecting what is going to be the amount of students in this particular area in 2015. But what's going to happen if these students actually go through the entire system and want to go to universities in 2020? And what we're finding is that we don't have enough universities to be able to accommodate all of these people. We're significantly under-resourced, significantly under-supplied. So then we start thinking about this idea of developing more cross-border higher education as a way forward, as the possibility of actually accommodating all the needs of these kids that are going to go through the system. Not all of them are going to go through the system. But if you can think of the amount of social unrest that might take place as a result of the fact that they can't find place in a university because even though they have the right grades, they're just starting up places. What's going to happen in terms of social unrest? So we need to look at choice, we need to look at flexibility, and we need to look at quality. So in this research, we found that there were 28 Asian Pacific countries that had significant growth or surpluses, and we had shortfalls in six. There's going to be increased competition between countries, and where demand far outstrips supply, and we're finding more increased mobility within the region itself. We're finding also that there's increased student expectations as a result of these placements or participation in school. And we're concerned about the affordability of education. And we're relying more and more on government to actually provide the funding. And that's rather unfortunate because in terms of diversifying funds and whatnot, the gift giving for educational purposes tends to be decreasing rather than increasing at this critical point in time. You'll find that Colin Power, who was one of the architects of the Millennium Development Goals, has identified that we're going from 5.5 billion USD in 2006 to only 3.3 in 2010. There's questions about political will the questions about promising certain outcomes, the idea that we're looking at short-term strategies versus long-term strategies just because of the electoral process. We're also finding that there are increasing issues related to quality, access, and equity. We have a proliferation of quality assurance agencies, a proliferation, an exponential amount, which I will show in a few minutes. But we're also finding privatization is on the increase, increases in distance ed or open learning models, and more women in the workplace. And in terms of the market, we're finding a regionalization of educational opportunities and school work schemes. We have an explosion of quality assurance agencies from international to state to discipline orientation. So if you can imagine a university going through throes of actually being accredited to be authorized as a university at one level, we also are finding that at the disciplinary level, we are also having to reach certain standards within that discipline, say business, for example. So an institution is constantly being evaluated, constantly being audited. We're finding that we're increasing the amount of blended delivery from face-to-face to online education. And UNESCO sees distance education as the vehicle of choice for our future. There are some success stories in international university cooperation, but there are many failures. And this tends to be based on leadership and the structures that we create to make them financially viable and successful. And again, let me stress this notion of financial viability. These international university organizations really are not able to work unless they're financially viable. So we're seeing more increases in privatization and this notion of a financial bottom line. I'm just going to give you just a general idea of how many of these international agencies exist currently. You'll see that they are segmented in terms of regions, but they are very, very prominent organizations that have a lot of say in terms of the control of these international university organizations. Now, why do I point these things out? Well, when Jane Knight and Hans de Witt were initially looking at internationalization, they wanted to look at quality of internationalization projects. So they came up with IQRP, International Quality Review Project, that was a peer-to-peer evaluative assessment of internationalization projects within universities. And so what they were doing was they were simply finding a cohort of people who were experts in internationalization and were flown to an institution to evaluate the internationalization practices of that university. What was problematic about it was the enormity of the cost of sending those experts to those locations. And so it didn't really pan out. And also the self-assessment of the IQRP. They had universities actually self-assess their internationalization projects. And oftentimes the university or institution was gratifying themselves in making it look like they were doing excellent, stellar work in internationalization. And all it was a checklist of hey, these guys are doing very, very well. Well, what these international university agencies and organizations are doing is they are looking at this from an external perspective, and they provide an external review process that may not necessarily be embracing a regional perspective or a nation state's perspective, and but they are growing. These type of organizations are proliferating around the world, and many of them are global in focus. Now, of the 700 some odd organizations that I've been able to identify so far, and again, let me point out to you that I think there are probably conservatively around 90,000 of these type of organizations, which is hard to find. I'm finding that there are different levels of cross-border higher education that is starting to emerge. We have distance education universities that are providing education across borders but by distance only. We have international alliances. We have even branch campuses that are doing some of this activity that are across borders within, say, a nation state. International consortia, corporate programs, open universities, branch campuses, international, and virtual universities. Now, there is a difference between distance ed universities and virtual universities, only in the sense of how the curriculum is laid out. A distance education tends to embrace this more blended approach, whereas virtual universities are completely online. The challenges ahead. As academia has done this over time and time again, we want to be everything to everyone. And that is something that we can't continue. We have to show difference. We have to show where our institutional commitment is through a vision, through this idea of focusing on specific stakeholders, and we need to start embracing that. It's in my opinion that we are still obsessed with world rankings. Many of these world rankings and league tables are very subjective in their orientation, and they need to change. The HALO program, while it should be applauded for being beyond accreditation, again, there are some major concerns about the HALO project in terms of standardization of teaching and learning. And then losing sight of greater purpose. It was Newman who came up with the idea of a university in the 1850s. And in the 21st century, we're finding that the university itself is not only disseminating knowledge, but advancing knowledge. But we're finding that we're advancing knowledge not for the sake of knowledge itself, but for the commodification of knowledge. Again, I'm worried about this idea about education as an investment.